Now, let us begin with the introduction to the thorax. Thorax is the upper part of the trunk being separated from the abdomen by a muscle called thoracoabdominal diaphragm, which is a partition between the thorax and the abdomen. This thorax is limited by the thoracic cage, which is made up of a single bone anteriorly in the midline, which is the sternum, and 12 pairs of the ribs on either sides, and posteriorly the 12 thoracic vertebrae. So the thoracic cage is made up of 12 thoracic vertebrae from behind, a sternum in front, and 12 pairs of ribs. All these together constitute the thoracic cage, which is limited above by this thoracic inlet. This is a thoracic inlet, and this one is the thoracic outlet. Inlet is smaller. Inlet is reniform in shape. It mid sagittal diameter is narrower than that of the parasagittal diameter, and this inlet is bounded in front by the superior border of the manubrium, and at the sides by the inner border of the first rib, and posteriorly by the first thoracic vertebra. So the boundaries of the inlet, again I repeat, posteriorly by the body of first thoracic vertebra, at the sides by the inner border of the first rib, and in front by the superior border of the manubrium. This manubrium is a part of the bone called sternum. The sternum actually is having three parts: the upper part, which is the manubrium; the middle longer part, which is the body; and the lower tapering part called the xiphoid process. The joint between the manubrium and the body is sternomanubrial joint, which forms a secondary cartilaginous type of joint, that is symphyseal joint. This is a thoracic inlet, and similarly let us talk about the thoracic outlet. This outlet is formed in front by the infrasternal angle, at the sides by the costal margin. This is a costal margin formed by the costal cartilages of the 7th, 8th, 9th ribs, and posteriorly the 12th thoracic vertebra. Posteriorly, this is a 12th thoracic vertebral body. So this forms the boundaries of the thoracic outlet. This thorax, the basic important or the larger organs within this thorax are the two lungs, and the portion in between the two lungs is the mediastinum, which contains the heart. We'll talk about the mediastinum later, but right now, again coming back to the thoracic cage, this sternum and the junction between the manubrium and the body of the sternum, which is coinciding with the second rib, is called the sternal angle. Sternal angle is the region between the manubrium and the body of the sternum. There is an importance to the sternal angle. This sternal angle is also called angle of Lewis. Sternal angle or angle of Lewis. This angle of Lewis is forms an important landmark where it coincides with the second rib. So the counting of the ribs as a rule should be done from the sternal angle. That is first importance. The second one being the arch of aorta, which is a continuation of the ascending aorta, begins and ends at this level. It arches upwards and backwards from the sternal angle, and again ends at the sternal angle to become continuous as descending thoracic aorta. So the beginning and ending of the arch of aorta. Number three, the thoracic duct, which is the largest lymphatic duct collecting the lymph from a lymphatic sac called cisterna cali in the region of the abdomen at the level of L1, From there, the lymph traverses through the thoracic duct from below upwards, and on reaching the sternal angle, it deviates from right side to the left side. So that is the third importance of sternal angle. And the fourth one, the sternal angle forms an important line of junction between the superior and inferior mediastinum. As I have said before, the region between the two lungs is the mediastinum. This mediastinum is actually divided into superior mediastinum and inferior mediastinum. Let us take a sagittal section. This is a sternum. This is the manubrium, body and xiphoid process. So these are the, I am drawing the bodies of 12 thoracic vertebra, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. If you take an imaginary line from the sternal angle, that is the junction between the manubrium and the body, to the level of T4, an imaginary line drawn joining the sternal angle with the body of T4 vertebra, this portion of mediastinum above the imaginary line is the superior mediastinum, and below that is the inferior mediastinum. So this sternal angle is forming an important landmark in dividing the superior mediastinum from the inferior mediastinum by this imaginary line. Within the inferior mediastinum, again we find the heart. The portion where the heart is located is the middle mediastinum. That means this one is the middle mediastinum. And the portion in front of the heart is anterior mediastinum. And the portion behind the heart is posterior mediastinum. So mediastinum overall is divided into superior and inferior, and the inferior one again is divided into anterior, middle and posterior mediastinum. Okay. So the fourth important event occurring at the sternal angle is it forms an important line of junction between the superior mediastinum and the inferior mediastinum. Coming to the fifth one, the sternal angle forms an important junction between two different dermatomes. The portion above the sternal angle is the C4 dermatome, cervical, fourth cervical dermatome, and the portion below it is T2 dermatome, that is thoracic 2 dermatome. In between C5 and T1, you know what is happening to it? It is taking part in the formation of the brachial plexus. So the sternal angle forms an important junction between two different dermatomes. The sixth one is the trachea bifurcates into two principal bronchi slightly closer to this level, if not exactly at the sternal angle, slightly above the sternal angle. Number seven, the superior vena cava opens into the right atrium close to this level of sternal angle. Number 8, the arch of azygous vein opens into the superior vena cava close to this level. And number 9, the attachment of superior sternopericardial ligaments is at this level. And number 10, the sternum moves forward and the backward during the process of inspiration and expiration at the expense of this sternal angle, which is contained with a cartilage between the manubrium and the sternum, manubrium and the body of the sternum. So these are all the events occurring at the sternal angle. Again, I repeat, number one, the beginning and ending of arch of aorta. Number two, the thoracic duct deviates from right side to left side. Number three, the line of It forms an important line of junction between two different dermatomes, that is the C4 and T2. Number 4, trachea bifurcates into two principal bronchi close to this level. Number 5, the attachment of superior sternopericardial ligaments. Number 6, sternum moves backwards and backwards, forwards and backwards at the expense of this joint. The next one, it forms an important junction between the superior and inferior mediastinum and likewise. So these are all the events occurring at the sternal angle. Now coming to the ribs, there are 12 pairs of ribs and there are 12 thoracic vertebrae. Of these 12 pairs of the ribs, from first rib to the 12th rib, the size of the rib starts increasing from first to 7th, and from there the size reduces from 8th to 12th. These ribs begin from the vertebra. They articulate with the thoracic vertebra behind. Let us take a rib. This rib articulates with the vertebra behind, and that portion where the rib articulates with the vertebra is called as the head of the rib. Then followed by this portion, which is the neck of the rib, followed by an elevated part which is called as the tubercle. Then we have the shaft. This is the shaft of the rib. This shaft bends abruptly forwards in the posterior aspect, and this is considered as the posterior angle of the rib. In fact, it is considered as the angle of the rib. And this is a shaft which consists of an upper border, lower border, outer surface and inner surface. And this is the anterior end of the rib. So the rib, it begins from behind with the head consisting of two facets which articulates with the facets on the body of upper and lower corresponding vertebra. So these two facets articulate with the bodies of the corresponding vertebra, whereas this tubercle should articulate with the facet present on the transverse process of the corresponding thoracic vertebra. Okay, so when we talk about the ribs, the number of the ribs are 12 in number, of which 7 ribs are having same features. 7 ribs are having same features, which are called as the typical ribs, and these ribs are 3rd to 9th. From 3 to 9 numbered, they are all are having the same features, since they are called as the typical ribs. So if you see this, this is a typical rib which are having certain basic features, like the head should have two facets, it should have a neck, it should have a tubercle, and it should have a shaft. And along the inner surface of the shaft, in its lower part, you can see this is the costal groove. These are the basic features of a typical rib. This is a costal groove containing the neurovascular bundle in it, that is the corresponding intercostal vein, corresponding intercostal artery, corresponding intercostal nerve, in an order V-A-N. So these are the basic parts of a rib. If you see the ribs, number wise, 3 to 9th rib are typical ribs, whereas 1st, 2nd, 10, 11, 12th ribs are atypical ribs. That means they are differing in the features from the typical rib. Okay. Similarly, if you see the vertebrae, there are 12 thoracic vertebrae. Not all the 12 thoracic vertebrae are not similar in shape or not similar in features. Hence, only 7 thoracic vertebrae are having same features, and the remaining 5 are differing, and hence there are 7 typical thoracic vertebrae, 5 atypical thoracic vertebrae. The typical thoracic vertebrae are number 1, number 9, number 10, the atypical thoracic vertebrae are number 1, number 9, number 10, number 11 and number 12. The remaining are typical. That means 2 to 8 thoracic vertebrae are typical vertebrae, whereas the remaining 1, 9, 10, 11, 12 are atypical. Why these are typical, why these are atypical, we'll study it in the next class. Is it clear now? This is about the thoracic vertebrae. Let us talk about the difference between the basic difference between the cervical vertebra and the thoracic vertebra is, the cervical vertebra consists of a small foramen in its transverse process, which is called as foramen transversarium. If you find a foramen in the transverse process, blindly you say it as a cervical vertebra. If you don't find a foramen transversarium in the transverse process, it has to be either thoracic or it has to be a lumbar. But the basic difference between the thoracic vertebra and the lumbar vertebra is the thoracic vertebra articulate with ribs. So its point of articulation is seen in the form of a groove in the body of the thoracic vertebra, which is called as costal groove, and in the form of a facet in the transverse process, which is called as costal facet. So the presence of the costal groove and costal facet with the absence of foramen transversarium in its transverse process is the feature of thoracic vertebra. Coming to the lumbar vertebra, how to identify a lumbar vertebra is, lumbar vertebra is identified by the presence of two processes called mammillary process and accessory process in relation to its transverse process and superior articular facet. This is in brief about the thoracic cage and basic parts of the bones concerned with the thoracic cage. Thank you.